While in the rest of Italy and in Europe, universities continue to be strictly male-only bodies, a young woman, Elena Lucrezia Cornaro di Scopia, was welcomed into Padua's academic community and granted a doctoral degree in philosophy. Today, Elena Cornaro is celebrated as an extraordinary example of intellectual power and as an early symbol of social recognition of a woman's capacity to think and to know in disciplines traditionally precluded to the human sex. A few biographies of Elena have been written. A splendid novel by Patrizia Carrano, titled Illuminata, was published in 2000, and the crater on Venus now has a name. However, as you've just heard, after her death, after a few decades, she quickly fell into oblivion. Her revival and the contemporary emergence of the life narrative of the first woman university graduate began in the 20th century, thanks to a fascinating American-European joint venture around the third centenary of her graduation in 1978. In what follows, I would like to provide an updated image of Elena Cornaro. Her life and career will illustrate the potential and the contradictions of her times and culture. They show the frictions between the will of fathers and the desires of daughters, between the idea itself of what a life devoted to knowledge for a woman could mean in the 17th century, and what she represented for her family and the academic and religious institutions around her. Her story makes for a fascinating piece of cultural history from a gender perspective. During her lifetime, Elena studied, wrote, and became an acclaimed public figure, but her inner thoughts, feelings, desires will escape us forever, mainly because she asked that all her writings be destroyed after her death. The erasure of proofs of her whole life of study surely speaks of Elena's unwillingness to make herself and her work known. But despite her modesty and self-restraint, her academic fame and the pride of her family made it possible for her to appear in written testimonies and a rather substantial iconography. Elena Lucrezia was a fine woman, with a head full of brown curls, which she tried her best to keep purely in place. She is visually represented with dark circles under her eyes, possibly the result of intense study, night vigils and fasting, and she dressed as a Venetian lady. What portraits do not know, and people did not know, is that she always wore a vest of rough black wool under her noblewoman's clothes. I would like to take this contrast between upper and lower layers of clothing as a relevant clue to Elena's identity, to the existence of a surface Elena and a hidden Elena, a public and a private self. On the one hand, the glittering, socialized body of the genius, and on the other, her woman body, which she tried to confine and almost refine out of existence in pursuit of knowledge and an intense spiritual and intellectual life. Elena Lucrezia was born to great wealth in June 1646 in an ancient Venetian family called the Medici of Venice. In its long history, the family could count 4 dukes, 9 cardinals, and the legendary Caterina Cornaro, Queen of Cyprus and Lady of Asolo. Elena's father, Giambattista Cornaro, was a Polish aristocrat who inherited and amassed great fortunes. He was the owner of one of the best supplied libraries in Europe, which was visited by many scholars who went there for research reasons from various countries. And he became the influential procurator, which means kind of treasurer of St. Mark's, which was the second important office, most important office in the Republic of Venice after the Duke. Elena's mother, Zanetta Boni, was a commoner, and as such, not being noble, she could not be taken as wife by the Conte Cornaro. Giambattista and Zanetta lived together for many years and had three of their five children, including Elena, before they could actually get married. In this sense, the family showed uncommon freedom from conventions, although Giambattista spent most of his life and a large part of his fortune trying to make up for these mixed origins, the socially unacceptable birth of his children, and Elena turned out to be his key to success. In the authoritative biography by Jane Howard Guernsey, Elena is presented as a kind of tragic genius, a gentle and complex girl surrounded by a series of pressing demands, which she tried to negotiate with courage and free will, although always mindful of her position in the Venetian hierarchy. The surface Elena seemed to have shared her family pride, and she actively concerned herself with her father's pursuits and with the public matters of La Serenissima. Although in 1669, she wrote that the highest ornament of women is silence, they are made to stay at home, not to go abroad. In her home, she was free to pursue learning and at the same time to actively support patriarchal authority and family fortunes with her intellectual virtuosity. As a member of various academies, she participated in philosophical and theological disputes and made many public appearances. According to her biographies of her biographers, however, these public demonstrations of her genius freed the spirit and contradicted her personal choices. Elena was serious, reflective, and deeply religious from her early years, and she gently but firmly struggled. She struggled with a luxurious life in the Grand Canal Palace, where she lived, and with opulent Baroque Venice, because she was naturally inclined to a simple life. She opposed the marriage plans and social demands of her family. She resisted her mother's disapproval of her desire for the convent. She battled with illness, anorexia, and the burden of international fame as a scholar, which her father greatly desired. Her independence shines in her decision to seal her commitment to austerity, to knowledge, and works of charity with an early vow of chastity. She was barely 11. And this was confirmed by her subsequent becoming a Benedictine oblate with the name of Scholastica. Elena continued to live at home and to wear regular clothes, but underneath was a Benedictine black robe. And beneath these layers was her suffering body. Elena subjected herself to bodily penances, and entering adolescence, she began to fast and to deprive herself of sleep. She seemed to suffer from a form of howling anorexia, similar to the one ascribed to early Italian female saints, like, for example, St. Catherine of Siena in the 14th century. It is impossible to say whether holiness was the motivation of this young woman, or whether her extreme behavior was a form of rebellion against family pressures in a time when women had little voice. Both explanations, I think, are feasible, but what seems certain is that the serious illnesses that plagued her life were the actual consequence of this disorder, which would finally cut short her achievements with her early death at 38, and also end her father's aspirations. Giambattista Cornaro, of course, he was no monster, he was no patriarchal monster. He had the merit of having realized the talent and the intellectual inclination of his daughter when she was just a child. From the age of 7, he provided for his exceptional girl the best tutors in many different subjects. We just heard that. Elena emerged as an outstanding linguist with deep knowledge of classical and modern languages, from Latin to modern and ancient Greek, Spanish, French, and English. That was very unusual in the 17th century for the English. And then Hebrew and Aramaic followed, which she needed for a closer study of the Holy Scriptures, and for which she had an exceptional teacher, the universis patavina libertas, which means universal, whole, and for all is Padua's liberty. This motto seemed broad enough to include women. With a doctoral degree, Elena would bring to family, city, and university the unique honor of an unprecedented recognition for a woman. Responding as usual to a sense of duty, Elena moved to the Cornaro Palace in Padua from Venice and started to prepare. Although she was appalled at the idea of any personal reward or recognition, when the time came for the graduation, she begged her father to abandon the quest for permission to defend her thesis publicly, and she fled back to Venice.